Welcome back to the CR News Show with us and see today. February the 24th, 2023 is today. It marks 1 year since the start of the war in Ukraine, and the war has disrupted the global economic climate that is still struggling to recover in the post-pandemic era.
However, there are a lot of changes on the global economy after 1 year. So how will this affect Indonesia and the Southeast Asia's economy? And for more on this, we are now with Bank Mandiri Chief Economist, Pak Andri Asmoro. Pak Andri, thank you so much for joining us here.
Thank you for inviting me.
It's a great pleasure for us to have you. So I'd like to start off with a question with the fact that actually both countries, Russia and Ukraine, are normally referred as the bread basket of the world. They are one of the biggest producers of natural resources, while Ukraine is the biggest, you know, producer of natural produce. So can you give us a glimpse of the impacts of the war towards Indonesia and the ASEAN's economy in particular if the war persists or if prolonged to, you know, another year? It has been 1 year up to today, but if it prolongs, what's the impact?
Thank you. That's a great question. Actually, at the beginning of the Russia and Ukraine war, we only expected that it's only last, let's say, 3 months or even the maximum of 6 months. That's why we made a stress test at the time. So below 6 months and also more than 6 months, of course the impact will be very different and significantly different. And we already actually witnessed that impact. So what's the impact of the prolonged war like what we had today? Actually, the number one is actually the supply chain disruption. Yeah, the Russia and Ukraine war affected to the, you know, more disrupted the supply chain and creating more expensive the logistic costs for the global trade, for example. And number two, I think the rising of the commodity prices. It's a good for Indonesia because Indonesia is a producer country. You already know Indonesia, the producer of the coal, of the CPO, rubber, nickel, and so on and so forth. So, but not for all countries actually. Many countries actually doesn't have the luxury like Indonesia. So the rising commodity prices means that the more cost and trouble for them. That's why many countries drop to become, you know, a failure country like Sri Lanka, for example, because they don't have any capacity to benefit from the war actually. So the rising commodity prices created both sides actually for Indonesia and ASEAN countries. Number one, from the energy one, because we are the net importer, oil importer, means that rising of the oil prices means more pressure for us. Last year the government actually increased the subsidized fuel price and creating more pressure for our inflation rate at the time. So with the prolonged war, for example, I think we have still have faced like a rising prices. So we have to mitigate what's the impact on to the food prices going forward, to the domestic inflation. So that's actually what we have to be concerned right now, even though actually right now many people and many business players actually already been like being not a surprise anymore, like what we had in the last year, when everyone's just got shocked, because of the war.
So it's actually a mixed, impact towards Indonesia's economy. For those who control like coal and nickel, bauxite, they are in advantage position. While if we're talking about oil, then we're in a difficult situation, right?
Last year, Indonesia's trade surplus was posted with the biggest or the record number, more than $54 billion of our trade surplus. Our current count from the deficit now become to the surplus current count. So many actually benefited from the war because of the rising commodity prices for Indonesia as well. The good thing for the government right now is that this is not a complacent for the government, of course. So they still manage how the impact of the rising commodity price doesn't have any impact on the domestic inflation, because people still have to deal with the rising costs and the so on and so forth. So last year we have Indonesia has 5.5% of the inflation rate, 5.3 economic growth. This is a good number comparing to other countries, for example, because last year everyone just thinking, after the government increased the fuel price, subsidized fuel price, the inflation could go up to 7% at the time, for example. But the government can manage the food prices, and the inflation dropped to 5.5%. And right now, we are seeing that the inflation rate could go down to 4%, for example, even below 4%. So that's actually an art, yeah, to dealing with all the positive and negative side from the war. Right. And we still believe, actually, it is like a black swan situation. Yeah. Nobody can predict, yeah, but we believe that until today that Russia won't stop the war. So means that we still have to deal with the prolonged war, yeah, for instance. Yeah. Yeah.
So what's very interesting is, as you've mentioned before, some surprising, you know, surprising effects in Indonesia is we were able to benefit out of a lot of it because according to the coordinating minister, Pak Erlangga, last year, he said that according to the year-end report, Indonesia has become a bright spot in ASEAN in terms of how we were able to benefit. Yeah. Now, if this war continues, though, do you think that we have what it takes to still be able to manage our resources that we can still benefit out of, you know, export surpluses or perhaps even gain more market share as
benefit? So I think we are now, we have to think beyond just anticipating the war because we already experienced it for 1 year. Now we are back, we have to think again how to become more productive. Anticipating for recovery going forward, for example, because we are just too long, in the last 3 years since 2020, for example, having a pandemic, COVID-19. Right now, I think everyone just think about how to create more value added for Indonesian, for example. That's why the government managed. The good thing about the government, once again, is that they can manage the COVID-19. So this is a big thing that everyone think is small thing, but for us in the economy, it's a big thing because the COVID-19 cases, the manageable COVID-19 cases means that there is no restriction on the mobility.
Yeah.
So the transaction now, the domestic economy becoming bigger and bigger. We are seeing that we will see in this year, for example, the consumption growth will be much more better compared last year, for example, because Pak Jokowi, our president, already lifted the PPKM, for example, the regulation. And that means that everyone can mobile and do the transaction, do the traveling, for example. We hope that many sectors will recover. That's number one. And becoming more productive, of course. Number two, I think the last strategy, last year's strategy and continue to today, for example, is how to downstream all the raw commodity sector, for example. The downstreaming really give value added, for example.
Yes.
So we just don't expect benefited from the raw materials or raw commodity. I mean, raw commodities prices only, and bring back to the trade balance. But also the downstreaming product, and then we go to the export rate that becoming more value added for Indonesia. So that's a big or a huge impact for Indonesia economy.
You know, on the previous hour, we talked with international relations expert about the war in Ukraine as well. And if the war prolongs, then it will create, you know, disastrous impacts on security, global economy, etc. But on the economic perspective, though, in terms of Indonesian reaction towards the war, what things need to be done differently from Indonesian side?
Yeah.
If it prolongs to, we never know, 2 years, three years, or the more.
I think what's been different, I think Indonesia is preparing for a more fundamental initiative, to make a stronger economy, a domestic economy. For example, like I mentioned, the urge or the initiative to downstream all the raw commodities, to become more, you know, giving the value added more to Indonesia. For number one, and number two, the digitalization, the improvement and the enhancement of the digitalization in Indonesia to become more efficient. Then number three, the government still keep continuing. Preparing for the human resources, improvement of the human resources capacity, for example. So when everything going back to normal, so we don't have any lack, for example, in many sectors. And number four, I think the government under our President Jokowi is trying to balancing the economic pie, between Java and outer Java, for example. And you can see, for example, greater economy coming from outer Java. So that's actually what makes it different. We just not just hoping or from the volatility of the commodity prices. The commodity prices could go down this year because the slower demand, slower global growth, the US economy only, you know, dropped to 1%, for example. India, Europe, the UK going into recession, for example, this year. So when we see this, actually we expect that the commodity prices maybe will go down this year. Means that we have to very hard to find another source of growth, for example. Yeah. That's actually what makes it different.
Okay. Yeah. I find it very interesting because you've mentioned the downstream one. This is the one thing that has been a target of President Joko Widodo since his very first term, that he wanted Indonesia to come to the next level of what we're capable of adding value to the country. And it's very interesting you also mentioned that it's the areas outside of the Java Island that's also seeing a lot of growth benefiting. Yeah. And because we've seen that Indonesia seems to be the bright spot in the region right now, as the holder of the ASEAN chairmanship, do you think Indonesia is capable of helping other member states mitigate, you know, the effects of the war as well?
Yeah,
it affects different countries differently.
Yeah, yeah. I think Indonesia has huge experience during the G20 last year. Yeah, you know, it was not a it was not an easy task for Indonesia during the Russia and Ukraine war. So you can imagine at that time, after Indonesia's chairmanship not long ago, not far from that, the Russia and Ukraine wars just come out, and then, you know, very difficult to dealing with that, balancing, between the political and also the economical issues in the time. So based on that experience, we believe that. And Indonesia is a long time well-respected, a very respected country and leadership in among ASEAN countries, of course. Yeah. So we believe that we can manage the G20 countries. And we can, of course, manage the ASEAN countries. And, you know, the hot spot in the global is in ASEAN countries, of course. Yeah, in ASEAN countries have many ASEAN countries have a growth more than 5-6%, unlike other regions, for example. Mm-hmm. And markets is here. Indonesia is one of the top five populated countries in the world, right? We have Singapore, the most advanced countries in terms of the services, for example. The Thailand, the basic of the automotive, and also tourism sector. So many actually opportunity and that Indonesia could, you know, more becoming the leader of that ASEAN countries in this.
I think, you know, talking about natural resources, also important for the EU member states that because of the war, they are exploring to reopen their coal sites and, you know, using natural-based energy yet again, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So Indonesia got the benefit of that because lots of European countries, they import coals from Indonesia as well as other natural resources products. But now Australia is open as well to export their coal to the EU member states.
Yeah.
So now the competition between Indonesia and Australia when it comes to coal has now been even because Australia has now opened the market as well. So what do you think about the prospect of coal amid, you know, our pledge to reduce our reliance on natural resources?
Yeah. That's why I mentioned many times that the prospect of the coal prices going forward is not as high as last year, actually. Yeah. The last year is actually a shocking time, it was an unprecedented, there was war. This year actually relatively precedented. When we talk about the recession, when we talk about the impact of from the war, already been discussed since last year. So nothing's new actually when we talk about the deceleration of the slower commodity prices. So we already expect that the coal prices, because of the supply and demand, the supply now is becoming bigger, and the demand from Europe, because of they're now becoming relying back again to gas, because I believe that the tunnel, the Nord Stream 1 and 2 already recovered, for example, after the, you know, disruption last year. The supply has already been quite recovered, and the needs for coal is not as high as last year, of course. And demand in the midst of global deceleration in 23, of course, the demand will be slower compared to last year, for example. So that's why we mitigate that coal prices may be relatively lower compared to last year. Last year, for example, you can imagine, the coal prices was above $400, $400 per ton. Mm-hmm. In fact, the break-even price is only $40.
Okay.
Yeah. So right now, already been cut or dropped to around $200 per ton.
Okay.
Wow. So it's significant drop.
Yeah. Well, it certainly is the shock time, and when people are desperate to look for resources,
yeah,
they found it, and now that people are starting to get used to accepting the new reality. We have another new normal, by the way. Another new normal after a new normal.
It's like, you know, when you watch the Star Wars episode.
Yeah.
So this is actually the episode 4.
Okay.
So far it's at 2020 and then the 22, 21.
There you go.
But you know what? It seems like it's going to be a bright time for ASEAN,
exactly,
at least this year. And hopefully we all get to benefit one way or another. Thank you so much, Andri, for coming and for enlightening us what happens in the economy. It looks very optimistic indeed.
Yes.
Thank you so much. And we're going for another break.
Yes, that's right. And after the break, I will deliver some economics and, oh no, Ranga will deliver some sports. Yes, right. I'm going to deliver some economics. Sorry for the confusion. We're talking about business right now.
He's going to continue to talk more.
I'm going to talk again about business economics right after this.